this sort of period between 2004 and 2007. There's a number of things that happen in here that in terms of technology that allow the crisis, the acute rapid onset crisis mapping that we view today to happen. And so it's sort of like laying the pipe, putting in the plumbing. The infrastructure is now available for us to use. So Google, opens up, first they acquire a company called Keyhole. Keyhole makes the prototype for Google Earth that we all know now, but they made it and sold it previously, and they were acquired by Google in 2004. And then Google opened up their API and relaunched Earth in 2005, and they opened up their Maps API so that anybody could come and build new applications from their map data. Started backing up in 2004, another service was brought online called OpenStreetMap, which if you haven't heard of it before, we'll talk a little bit more about it later on today, but it was a really critical piece in Haiti during the earthquake in Haiti that we'll talk about the documentation of later. But at the same time, things like Facebook is starting, later on Twitter is starting, and this image that I'm showing here is the National Holocaust Memorial Museum's Crisis in Darfur. So this is one of the first times where an internet-based mapping resource is used for clear public advocacy for a specific thing that is, and you could be termed part chronic and part acute crisis, right? It's a long-standing acute crisis. The Sudanese government is consistently throughout, putting more militias into Darfur and is burning more villages. And so it takes some time for that satellite imagery to become available on Google Earth. But this is the first time where maybe you can sit at your home in America and you can zoom in on a particular town and just with your regular laptop and see a burned village, burned to the ground. You can see video documentation, you can see photos. You can't deny it, and that's really critical. So that's one really critical aspect of crisis mapping. Okay, thanks. So along comes a tool called Ushahidi. You might be familiar with Ushahidi. It's a technology tool that was born out of the election violence in Kenya at the end of 2007. Presidential election was disputed, and then after that, there was a lot of ethnic tension and violence around that. So Ushahidi was built basically to try to get information from the ground that wasn't really flowing into a common repository for people to be able to visualize it, to see it, to connect with it. And so, this is the very basic frame for Ushahidi at the very beginning when they first started. You can see here that there are layers of things like riots, deaths, property loss, looting, things like that. Critically, you can submit an incident online, but what most people have in Kenya is a very basic Nokia cell phone at this point. And so you could send a text message to this short code, and if it was approved and it wasn't disinformation, it would be put up on this map. And it directed resources, for sure. It directed media attention to a specific location. Any number of those things happened, so it brought more attention to this issue of the rioting that was happening. Can you go ahead just for a second? Forgot to mention our friends David Cobia and Eric Hurstman over here. This is another critical juncture in crisis mapping, which doesn't really get its due. In May, there was a NetSquared challenge that Ushahidi won. It was only $10,000, but without winning that, they probably would have put Ushahidi on the shelf and not continue to develop it, and not certainly not develop it into the open source platform that it is today, where there are literally hundreds of people doing crisis mapping and widening the conflict, trying to get more attention drawn to their issue, get more advocacy, their eyeballs on their issue. This was absolutely critical. So, in November 2009. There was a meeting, the first meeting of these termed crisis mappers, and it was a small conference room in Orlando. This is not the most glorious or glamorous of occasions, but it was a really great, excellent meeting. And so it did, at that point, start. You could start to sense the differentiation between people who were focused on the acute, rapid onset crisis, things like Kenya, things like earthquakes and floods and other things like that, and people who were definitely interested in the chronic, long-term crisis, things like poverty, climate change, other issues like that we'll talk about in a bit. So this map here is, you know, sort of Ushahidi 2.0, where it's used in the deployment by another organization, not Ushahidi. It's deployed by Al Jazeera to do to document the attack on Gaza in the beginning of 2009. And at sort of the end of this timeline here, in May of 2009, we're seeing more credibility thrown at Ushahidi's way. They're getting funding, and people are starting to think that that they're important. Before I get to the game changer, which is Haiti here, in this very university in 2009 was the International Conference on Crisis Mapping. Out in the Great Hall here, we met to have a nice little gathering. And what is absolutely critical about that meeting was that it was the first time that a much larger group of people got together to discuss crisis mapping in an open way. And the connections and the meeting, the space, the ability for people to talk to one another, meet one another, get to trust one another at that meeting laid the groundwork for the collaboration that happened in Haiti just 3 months later, 4 months later. It was absolutely critical that we had that meeting, and it's just it's something that should definitely go into John Carroll University's history books, I think. Ushahidi again, they're a big player here in the space. I'm talking about them a lot, but in terms of laying the tubes or laying the network, the infrastructure for crisis mapping, and in a wider way, volunteer mapping, you know, other things, they're really critical. So they win a much larger sum of money that is able to, they're able to roll out sort of more Ushahidi 3.0, and they're keeping going down the road. And then Haiti. Haiti was a devastating atrocity. We'll talk about that later. It was a natural disaster in some ways, but a man-made disaster in many other ways. The efforts around Haiti, which have been documented many times, there's an entire Disaster 2.0 report that's been released just recently by the UN Foundation that I think you all, if you're interested in this talk, you'd be interested in reading that. It was a very different type of crisis, in that it was an acute crisis on top of an already chronic crisis that was going on in Haiti for a long period of time. But the ability for the crisis mapping community to get data to first responders, to be able to close the loop on some things, was viewed as a necessary thing now from the humanitarian community. The humanitarian community, I don't think, would be at a loss in some ways without this type of data. Okay, so then even further to sort of thinking about in a political sense widening the conflict, we have the oil spill crisis. The oil spill happens in the Gulf in May of 2010, and this is sort of maybe the first environmental crisis map where we're getting reports of people seeing oil on the beaches and tar walls and things like that. We're also seeing more professionalization of crisis mapping. At the crisis mapping meeting last year, the International Conference on Crisis Mapping in 2010, we're seeing more professionalization by the launch of the Standby Task Force, which Jen is an integral part of. So we're seeing more issues around the professionalization of the space, but also more legitimacy to the group of people that are doing crisis mapping because of that professionalization. And finally, again, to legitimacy, we've had many, many crises just come up in the last, since the beginning of the year. We've had, obviously, the Egyptian Jane 25 revolution. We've had the Christchurch earthquake, very similar in size and scope to the Haiti earthquake in terms of geologic event, but we'll talk about the differences in them in a second. And obviously, the earthquake in Japan, the tsunami, the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power disaster, And you know, there are many crises that we've had, all of which have had some support from the crisis mapper community and volunteer mapping. People are getting out there and saying, I have some piece of information that would be of value to everyone. I need a forum to be able to dump that information to. Who do I go to? And the crisis mapping community has been the place for people to go to that information. So I think with that, we're going to talk about community resilience.
So JD gave a great timeline talking about the trajectory of crisis mapping with regards to acute crises. And the Ushahidi platform was developed as an instrument to gather reports from the field during an acute crisis and even afterwards. Many of you are bloggers, you know, you're familiar with WordPress. Ushahidi is both a platform and an organization, but it's also a piece of open source software. And you can use it for anything that you would like to gather information from the public, anything that a community sees as necessary to mapping their own community. So with that, I'm going to talk about building community resiliency with crisis mapping, with applications and technology like Ushahidi, and a little bit about the chronic versus acute crises. Okay, so let's think about resiliency and what this means. This is something that as geologists we're very used to seeing. This particular graph here shows that there's only so much stress a material or a system or a building can take before it fractures. And that's its resiliency, the ultimate point at which it fractures, how much stress it can take. So you could say, Haiti versus Christchurch, which a situation I'll talk about, had different levels of resiliency when it came to acute crisis. But we all know that chronic crises also, there's levels of resiliency there too. We think of poverty or you think of hunger or other kinds of chronic issues. So we're going to talk about resiliency and crisis mapping. So just to talk about this a bit more, thinking about an iceberg. So the very top that you see here is the acute crisis. Natural disasters, man-made disasters, but response here is critical. It's moment to moment, day to day. Here, the rest that sometimes it's harder to see or it's fractionated in our view are the chronic crises. Issues like poverty, but also climate change vulnerability, urban neglect, urban agriculture, urban farms, things that maybe not even just in the negative, things that might be seen as in the positive too. Mapping out resources and points of pride builds the resiliency of the community. Issues like sexual harassment, which we'll talk about in application of Ushahidi for rampant sexual harassment will lead to declining resiliency. All these things in the chronic contribute to what happens in the acute. So as JD said, Haiti is not a natural disaster. We're both geologists, it was a natural disaster in the sense that there was an earthquake involved, and actually the earthquake, although there's some differences, they're mostly very similar earthquakes, very shallow, similar fault structure near urban areas, but orders of magnitude of casualty difference between Christchurch, New Zealand, and Haiti. And why is that? It's, we could all probably come up with a reason if you've been to Christchurch or a place like Christchurch and what some of the differences might be in just a priori way, but essentially this difference is resiliency. So in this sense, Haiti was not an man-made disaster. What was not a natural disaster?